We're going to start out with handguns, okay? There are a couple things in terms of self-defense generally. You can sit down and relax. You don't have to stand. You know, you just woke up. If a person holds you up with a handgun, you give them anything they want except your life, your body. Okay, that's where you draw the line, because if they can take you to a secondary scene of the crime, whatever could happen is probably going to happen a lot worse. Okay, if you decide a person with a handgun, it's amazing how many of them are not functioning properly, aren't even loaded, maybe loaded with wrong caliber bullet. It does happen. Okay, some of the people out on the street do not have their marbles connected. Okay, so that raises a possibility of getting away. If you have to run, the rationale a long time ago was to run zigzag, because that way the person couldn't take aim. But if you again have a few marbles, all you do is hold your hand and down their center line, and as they cross that center line, you fire. So zigzagging doesn't work. Most recent thinking I've come across is to run in an arc away. Now this requires some, you know, real presence of mind when, you know, someone's going to be shooting at you in the back. But the odds are you have a much better chance of surviving than if you go into their car or go wherever they want you to go. Okay, that's a real sad commentary, but it's a reality you have to face. Same thing as a side issue. How many of you are married, have kids? Okay, do you have a fire drill practice for your house? Do you have an alternate way to get out of the house if you can't go out the front or back door? Okay, that's important. Okay, now, here's the rationale. When I was a school teacher, when I was a kid, we used to have drop drills. In the 50s, those were in case of a nuclear attack, so that you would get under your desk and hope you didn't make too much of an ash of yourself. Okay, but they wouldn't tell us that reality. Okay, those drop drills became earthquake drills when someone finally connected the dots. It was a real easy transition. Okay, if you are in your house and you have someone break into your house, your goal is to get everyone in the family out of the house as fast and as safely as possible. You don't want anyone left in the house, so the person who breaks into the house, if they're just there to burglarize a place, you're relatively safe. If they hear a noise, they'll leave. Okay. On the other hand, if it's a home invasion, it's a whole different ball game. Everybody needs to get out. And if you as a parent scream fire, that's an indication to the kid to get out of the house, not come running to mommy. Okay, because running to mommy in a home invasion can be a real disaster for the kids, and then parents get stressed. You know, obviously there are a lot of things that come into a play, but you want everyone out of the house and run next door down the street and get someone else to call the police. Okay, and that's just something you want to do for your own and kids' safety. You know, there could be a house fire, but if you train them for one thing, it will surprisingly. They don't need to see fire to know, because they've had training in school too. You know, fire drill, what do you do? You get out. But you get out of the house. One thing to be aware of with handguns, as well as, let me get this thing undone, as well as rifles, you want to be as close as possible. If you're going to do a self-defense technique, you want to be as close as possible to the weapon. Okay. There's another thing that goes on in here, and this is also in the new book. It's called situational awareness. And this is, it's in the martial arts, it's called the sixth sense, quote unquote. You need to be aware of what's going on around you. Okay, and this doesn't mean becoming paranoid and looking around, you know, all the time, because that's going to, for someone who is going to be a mugger, that's a signal that you're very insecure, and it's an indication then that you will probably make a better victim because you're nervous. There are also some other signal, you know, other physical things people do that make them good targets. It's amazing what information has come out of the University of California at San Quentin. But anyway, it's USSQ. Okay. But in any case, you need to be as close to the weapon as possible. If he stand there, if he pulls a handgun and he's there and you can't do anything from here, okay? You're too far away. The bullet is going to travel faster than your hand will. Okay, you've got to get close to your attacker. Okay, now he's got a pretty good hand grip. You want to bring, if he tells you to raise your hands, you don't do an armpit check. Okay, you keep your hands at chest level. Okay, now why is your gun down? He's not playing fair. Okay, now what you need to do here is you need to have a distraction. Okay, and then you go for the weapon. We train in the martial arts. If you want to defend yourself, you control their body. Okay, with a gun or a rifle, you have to control the weapon, because all it takes to fire that weapon is this finger. Okay, and you can't get to it because it's usually protected by the guard. Okay, so that's not an option for you. Okay, so now you also have to be aware that if you're going to grab an automatic weapon, okay, if you grab a revolver like this, you're probably safe because the cylinder has to rotate in order to fire. Okay, and if you have a good grip on the if you have a good grip on the cylinder, you're probably safe. This thing is not going to fire. Okay, there is a chance with a revolver that you may get the firing pin may end up in your little finger. Okay, I've had that happen once. It hurts like hell. Okay, but the weapon will not fire. No, the gun wasn't loaded, and I didn't plan to have my little finger over the edge of the. But that happens, okay? It was a little bloody, and you know it hurt like hell. But you go on, okay? Then we wipe the blood off of everybody, okay? But in any case, with an automatic, because the cylinder slides, and it depends where the exit. What's the port called? The exit. Anyone know the proper name? What?
Ejection port.
It's possible that where you're grabbing could be over the ejection port. If you don't prevent the gun from firing, okay, you may get second or third degree burns on your hand, okay, which is probably going to cause some permanent scarring. Okay, there may be some tearing of your hand as a weapon discharges, but it's better than having this go into you. Okay, it's everything is relative with a weapon. It's like with knife attacks, you assume you're going to get cut. You have to assume that. Okay, those are givens. Okay, you're going to, so what we're going to do here, just get, now that we're past the mechanics, okay, he's going to come up here and he's got this. Do you know your safety is on? Okay. Now, you've got to have a distraction. It can be verbal, it can be movable, hand, twitching of a finger, anything that takes his mind off of what he's doing, even if he doesn't realize it. Okay. First one we're going to give you is you're going to grab it from the inside, and you're simply going to turn this in towards him. This part you need to do slowly. And take your finger out of thank you. Okay. And what you're going to do from here is simply, you've got the gun like this, you're simply going to bring it down against, let go of the hand grip. Okay, if he had his finger in here, okay, You're going to bring it down. Now, the gun may fire. He shoots himself. Big deal. But what, as you pull this down, you're going to break his index finger. You may, I forget what the term is, if you, when you take the skin off. It's, pardon?
Deglove.
You deglove the finger, which means they will probably have to surgically remove the finger because you can't put all that skin back, okay? And then he won't be able to, he can only count to 9, okay? And then you need to step back. Make sure you're going to pull, I forget what the term is, the slide? Yeah, pull the slide back to make sure you have an active round in there. Step back and say, stay down, okay? Okay, now, do you have the right to shoot him? That depends on what state you're in. Geographically, not mentally. Okay, I mean, you may just fire because you're upset. Okay, and that can happen. I won't say where you should aim for. I would usually, based upon the UC San Quentin, I would probably go for the lower abdomen. Okay, the head is too small of a target. Okay, if he had a bigger head, he probably wouldn't be engaged in this type of occupation. So, in any case, he's here. You've got to have some sort of distraction. Okay, turn it and just turn it, bring it back, step back, advance the slide to make sure you got an active round, and tell him not to move. Okay. If you have very good aim and are relatively calm, you can try a shot between his legs a little lower than the important places. Okay, and that will usually encourage a person to stay still. Okay, I'm being facetious, but okay, any questions on the technique? It's a relatively simple one, okay, but you've got to come in, you have to grab the weapon very aggressively, like you've got to put a death grip on it, because if you have a good enough grip, it's going to prevent the weapon from firing and it's going to jam, which is why after you're done, you need to advance the slide to get that round out of there and hopefully have a working weapon. Okay? Okay, any questions?
What do you recommend doing with the left hand?
On this technique, nothing.
Okay.
You wave at him, you know. Or any, you know, that's all I'm doing. The mind will pick up that hand, and that's what gives you about 3 to 7 tenths of a second. Okay. I don't advise coming in, you know, trying to grab and then kicking the guy. Okay, because your concern is the weapon. Okay, don't kick and then grab. Don't hit and then grab. You've got to have some type of distraction, and then you need to go for the weapon. And again, if all he wants is your money, your clothes, your pet poodle, except for Corky, who's a vicious dog. Okay. You know, anything they want, except you, your body, and that's where you have to draw the line. Okay, you'd much rather be shot out on the street where other people can see it and you have a chance of getting medical attention. Okay, that's a sad comment to make too, but again, it's another reality. Okay, we're doing the serious stuff now so that we can do lighter stuff later in the day. Because we got to leave, when you leave here, you have to feel good and positive rather than, God, this is frustrating. Okay, this is really sad and scary. Okay. I've never had a gun pulled on me. I've had a knife pulled on me in school by an adult gang member. He was arrested. His stupidity was changing the knife back and forth between his hands to impress me. It was so easy. There's a whole story behind it, but you know, he went down. The police, this is before you had, we had a school security officer, but at that time they didn't allow security officers to be armed. You know, what use were they? Okay. anyway, so we had to call the real police, and which you don't have to do nowadays. You know, most schools, if they have security guards, they're armed, which is a sad commentary, but that's something else. Okay, so enough of La Boca. We have nine handguns here, and
you've got four more over here,
and I don't care whether it's a revolver or automatic. When you come in, this, whenever you grab either left or right side, you've got to grab this as if your life depended on it, okay? Because it does, okay? Because he may see this and he may jerk back, and you've got to be able to go with him. That's another thing in the book. You always help your attacker, okay? Because if he jerks back and you pull this way, okay, aim right here, right there. Make it a nice clean shot. Anyway, yes, sir.
What if you're just resorting to your muscle memory and he's a lefty and you grab it with the right?
I'm left-handed. Left-handed people, and I hate to say this, left-handed people have a definite advantage in the martial arts. Because we've been discriminated against all our lives. We've had to learn to do so much right-handed. Okay. Left-handed, if you're a sensei and you teach your students to do stuff right-handed, they learn it. But get them to do it left-handed takes a lot more time, okay? Because they've got to, oh my God, I've got to use the other side of my brain. But left-handed people have had to deal with this all their lives, okay? I used to work in a machine shop, and my boss would occasionally say, when I was a teenager, I worked in a custom machine shop, and he knew I was left-handed, and I was somewhat ambidextrous, and he'd occasionally say, would you like a left-handed screwdriver? Just to give me a tough time. Some of you have to think about this. But anyway, okay. But we can do stuff left-handed fairly easily. So I'm still going to be this. I'm actually going to be faster left-handed than I am right-handed.
I mean, if you use the same
distraction,
used to doing practicing it right side. You get the 1 out of 10 that's left-handed, and you grab with the right hand. Is it still going to work?
You're going to have to do something else. Oh, right hand. I'm sorry. Okay. If he's here, okay, I'm going to have to do something else. Okay, and that's something else. Quickest thing, which was going to be the next technique, so I like to have one technique have some relation to the next technique, is going to be you're coming, grab his wrist, and pull this back towards him and bring him down. Okay? And if he wants to fire it, okay, he gets a see-through. More than that, maybe, but that gets messy right there. Anyway, yeah, you've got to grab it, because this by itself is very weak. Okay, he can get out of this. Okay, but once you come in and grab that wrist, now you've got something you can work with. And considering you're pointing the weapon at him, that's even more serious for him. Okay, and then from here, okay, rather than taking it this way to try and bring it, you want to take it down behind him, and that way you can get the weapon. Because again, it's his finger that's going to get broken. If you have the weapon, your next move, this is a good impact device. Okay, your just weapon is going to come back and smash him on the side of the head. So not only does the weapon get an imprint into the side of his head, but you've got some DNA. Okay, that's not, I'm being, trying to be somewhat facetious, but that's going to be the second technique, okay? So, first one, all I want you to do, he's going to come up. Oh, man, this is a third time tonight. Okay. And you continue to make sure, again, don't have your finger inside the trigger guard, okay? Keep it outside. And then you're going to step back, slide, advance the slide, stay down. Okay? Any questions? Good. Okay. What I'm seeing some of you do is you're doing, you know, it's a way, and then you're going out like this, sideways, and you're going out like this. Okay, the weapon is pointed out that way. Okay, what I want you to do, and I'm going to do this very slowly because I don't want to break his finger, is you when you turn this, you turn it up towards, let go with your fingers so I can show. You want to turn up towards his head, and that allows the trigger guard to move all the way up to the base of his finger. Okay, and at that point, that's when you pull. Okay. See here, hold. Okay, here, he can pull his finger out. That's not a serious break. Okay, or it can slide out. You get down to here, you've got something pretty good. Okay, that's what you're after. This is not about being nice. This is about giving him something to remember. Well, you don't care, but you know, it's you need to get this all the way up, and it's the weapon, instead of going around, okay, should go around and up towards him. Because see how it hooks in? Okay? Because that's the way his hand, a normal hand, moves. So you want to help him. Okay? Very good. Okay, thank you very much. Some of you are still at this distance and you're reaching for the weapon, okay? This is not going to work. Okay? By the time you reach, even with the distraction, he's going to pick up on. You've got to get close. You want to help him. He needs help. You can't help a person from out here. All you can do is talk to him, okay? But you know, you've got to get close enough so that your hands aren't coming from the front towards him, but they're coming from the side. Because he can't pick up on that as easily if he's looking at you, okay? So you want your technique coming from the side, linearly, okay. The other issue you had, and you brought up, why can't you do this, okay, and instead of stepping back and down, bring it in to him so he shoots himself, okay? Now, if he ends up in court and he says, well, this is what I did, and I pushed it into him so he would shoot himself, we don't have anyone here who's an attorney? Not today.
Or Sensei Kirby said to
me. Okay. You are then saying you did something with the intent of causing him to be shot. And guess who may need an attorney? Okay? You. Okay? Because you knew what you were doing. The weapon fired. You knew what would happen. You did it with intent. You know, it's sad that the world works that way, but you have to CYA. So you would never say, you know, I did it because you're... Okay. And we've been through this in previous seminars, okay, in terms of... not talking to the law enforcement right away and things of that sort until you calm down and know exactly, you know, have a pretty good idea of what you did and what happened. Okay. The other issue, so, you know, there is a rationale for most of the stuff that I'm doing. So you want to be close enough, and you want your, whatever you're doing, coming in from the side rather than towards him. Okay. If he sees this, he may take a step back and then, this is not going to work, okay? Okay. Other issue came up. Well, some of you were grabbing with one hand, starting and grabbing with the other. If you can get the second hand in there, fine. It will give you additional support, okay? And this becomes again, easy to do. What you have to watch out for, which one person did, okay, is when they did this, their hand slid over the...
Ooh.
Okay, that's a good way to get hole in hand, okay, or lose some fingers or what have you. So if you're going to grab with two hands, make sure that you are as close to the hand grip and trigger guard as possible. Okay, you don't want this hand up here or here. We're going to risk losing things if the gun fires. Okay, your number one rule is to protect who?
Yourself.
Yourself. Okay. So, okay. Next issue. Okay. We're going to start off with the same thing again. Okay. He's up here. Okay. Your shoelace is untied. Okay. Now, this time I'm going to come in, I'm going to grab the hand. Okay. And again, anytime if you want to grab the wrist, fine. That's another option. Okay. It gives you more support. And this time you can either do the same technique, okay, or if you want, you can take it to the right and pull it away, okay, and out, okay, and again, step back, okay, so he's here, let's get closer, I took a shower, okay, he's here, you've grabbed, you knocked out, you're going to grab, okay. Now, you got to have the presence of mind to grab the wrist of the handgun, okay? You still have to control the weapon with your right hand, okay? And this time, you're going to bring it out and down and away from him. You've got the weapon in your hand. Yes, you could step back, or you could inadvertently strike him in the head and then let go and slide, step back, okay? Depends on how aggressive you want to be now that you have the weapon. Okay, I cannot tell you what I would personally do. Okay, probably hitting him in the side of the head with the weapon is probably going to be considered reasonable force, considering he was going to shoot you. But I'm not an attorney. Okay, so what I want you to do, he's here. Your belt's untied. Okay. Now, what you have to realize is that by the time you finish with your, if it's going to be a verbal statement, by the time you've finished your verbal statement, you have to have moved in physically. Okay? Here, take it away. I'm going to come back, strike him in the side of the head. Okay? Again, the weapon does not point to me at any time. Okay? Is there a possibility you might shoot this gun might discharge and shoot someone else? Yes. Who's responsible for that? I don't know. Okay. Probably he will. Because he had the weapon. Okay. Okay. And, you know, and then step back. And some of you are saying, stand there. Okay. Stand, he may turn and run, and then you have to... You know, don't try and shoot him in the back, number one. If the person tries to get away, you can stop them, but now you become the aggressor, okay? That's not cool. If you say get down, and he gets down, then you are in a safer position, okay? Because he knows he can get shot, because he's going to have to get up before he can go anywhere. Okay. Now, once the police show up, and this is really important. If the police have not already shot you, no, I shouldn't say that. assuming, you know, it depends where you live in terms of how long it'll take the police to get there. Okay, where I live, within a minute or two, really fast, okay, we have very good police coverage in our community, okay, the city pays for the extra coverage, and crime rate obviously goes down, okay? What you need to do is, once you see a police officer, is you put the gun down, you step away from the weapon with your hands visible, okay? That's the safest thing to do. Don't say, he tried to rob me, because the officer doesn't know whether he's the victim or you're the victim. He doesn't know. Go into that in the book too, to some extent, okay? And just to mention this, and I think you're police officer, okay. When you're defending yourself as individuals, you're defending yourself, the public sees you as a defender. Okay, you are trying to protect yourself from injury. When they see a police officer trying to apprehend a person, the public many times sees them as the aggressor, because they're physically engaging this other person and trying to control them for whatever reason. Okay, and so the public sees them as the aggressor. However, okay, and the reality is, yes, they are being the aggressor. However, they're there for law enforcement, and that is their role as determined by the government. Okay, they're there to protect the rest of us. Okay, so yeah, maybe they do have to become the aggressor, but it doesn't, the aggressor defender definitions that we use in common life isn't that simple. Okay, so it's something you have to be aware of. Okay, two, if I'm trying to arrest him, and he was just standing there, you know, drinking his beer, his fourth beer, fifth beer, okay, and I try arresting him, the public may see me as the aggressor, but I'm doing my job, okay. There's a video, I guess, it was on TV a couple of nights ago of two police officers were being charged with excessive use of force in some city in California. And they had a 19-year-old they were trying to detain. One officer was trying to detain, weighing 200 pounds, which is a good, you know, he was as tall as the other officer. And they didn't show the first part of the clip, which I think was seriously missing. But it showed the 19-year-old trying to get away from the officer, and then the officer swung at him. That was the start of the video, which was, you know, it looks like the officer is the aggressor. Okay, they eventually controlled the suspect perpetrator. You know, he's taken down, cuffed. Another officer swung at him with his baton at the knee to bring him, which is what brought him down. And they were both being charged with excessive force. And I said, and my wife asked, well, which is this right? And I said, well, the officer that swung with his baton struck to the correct area, did the right thing, it did bring the perpetrator down. The first officer, because I didn't see what was going on before he swung at the perpetrator, I don't know what happened. And that was unclear. So, but if you just looked at that video, it looked like both officers were aggressors. But that is their job. Not to be an aggressor, but to enforce the laws. Okay, so you have to make that differentiation. Yes, there are. If you look at the Rodney King tapes from '94, I mean, that was an obvious mess, and that was before I was involved in the LAPD. I saw that video. I said, "Oh, geez." Okay. Yes.
So I find that our public transit here, the police can take like 10 to 15.
The police can what?
The police can take like 10 to 15 minutes, maybe shorter if you're lucky. But what happens, like, what should I be doing if I have to hold somebody on the ground or in some kind of hold for 10 to 15 minutes? What can I do? Like, what questions or, like, asks can I make of the people around me? Like, what kind of support should I, what kind of direction should I be asking?
If you have to hold a person down, okay, and I had one black belt who was in that position years ago. And the people around him, he had the guy on a shoulder lock pin, and he was afraid because one of his legs was falling asleep, and he was afraid he was going to have to get up. The guy was complaining, "You're killing me." This is in downtown LA. It took the police 10 minutes to get there. He was arrested for purse snatching and an attempted assault with a screwdriver on the black belt. The purse snatching was from another lady, but the guy was screaming, "You're hurting me, you're hurting me, you're hurting me," and the crowd was saying, "Kill him, kill him, kill him." If you are in a situation where you have to keep them down, this is going to be a simple excuse, and you need to be using some type of hold that you can maintain while you are in a relatively comfortable position. Okay, 10 minutes is a long time. 5 minutes is an extremely long time. Okay, if that's all I can really say. You need to have it has to be a good lock. You don't want to be. I don't want to say you don't want to, it's hard to say, but again, you want to be into something that you can maintain without a lot of muscular effort, because 10 minutes is a long time to keep a person pinned on the ground. If you're like, you know, you've got a full Nelson on their face down, or, you know, even a shoulder lock pin, if you're stuck on the ground with them for 10 minutes, that's hard to maintain. And you're not, you know, 300 pounds, 6'10". So you're probably going to rely on a joint lock. It's either going to be a wrist or something like that, that is really, you know, most appropriate for you, because you can still look feminine, and this guy can be screaming, "You're breaking my wrist." Okay. So.
Do I ask people?
You really can't. Okay. If people are getting too close, you really, and it's hard to say, because they just may want to see what's going on. You don't know whether this person has friends, okay? You need to really pay attention to what they're saying, which is another hard part. If they sound threatening to you, or the person does, you need to direct yourself to that one person, if possible, or two people, and say, "If you get any closer, I'm going to have to break his wrist. I don't want to break his wrist." And that's because that's the only option you have, okay? You need to back away or get away. You keep your language, and you'll agree, I know you're agreeing with that, you keep your language as short. You don't say, please move away, because if you don't move away, I may have to break his wrist. I don't want to break his wrist, because if I break his wrist, then we have to call paramedics. And if we call the paramedics, it's going to take time, and he's going to have to have time. They're not going to listen to that. You say, "If move back. I don't want, you're going to force me to break his wrist." You keep it as short as possible. And you need to look at them so they realize, you know, eye-to-eye contact can be tremendously effective, okay? But you need to keep whatever you're saying to as short as possible and clear. Okay, you may have some poor little waif of a young lady who looks perfectly innocent pull out a .357 with a 15-inch barrel. No. Okay, in all seriousness, you need to watch my body. Okay, what I'm seeing is some of you are, you're going like this, okay? You need, and I may have erred myself by not moving my body, okay? You've got to get your body out of the line of sight as much as possible. It's like a knife, okay, but a lot faster. So when I move in, okay, I need to get my, this takes it out of the way. If you're going to come this way, what I'm seeing is some people going like this. And you've got to get your body out of the line of sight of the weapon as soon as possible. Okay. And I'm not blaming anyone, because it's something I may have failed to stress. Okay. But in any technique, any weapon, any, you know, learning any technique, it's the small things that mess us up in life. Okay. If any of you have ever been audited audited by the IRS, it's usually something, a small mistake you made that they're trying to get some money on. I was audited about 25 years ago. It took them 3 hours to get $35 out of me. The IRS agent was tremendously professional, polite. She said, this should have put here, that should have been put there. Okay, and in the end, they got that included the penalties. okay, we had a very nice, you know, but I was able to, I had the financial records to support everything, but it just took them a very long, you know, they did not make money on the deal. Okay, so, but it's the little things that mess us up in life. Okay, you need to get your body out of the way of the direction of the weapon as soon as possible. Okay, very good. That's all I wanted to say. You're safe. Okay, some of you are coming in with interesting ways. Back over a second. Interesting ways of hitting the. Some are people coming in this way. The punch. I think you're coming in this way. Okay, that's okay. I mean, I can't say which is the right way to hit the person in the head with the butt of a gun. Okay. I was taught coming, and I simply because of the way it was taught to me, you know, and so it does mean it's the only way to do it. I was taught to come in this way to the side of his head because it leaves a very distinct mark. I mean, you hit a person with this part, they're going to have a very distinct mark too. Okay, and they're probably going to need some stitches. This will also leave a very distinct mark on the side of their head, and
just don't point the weapon at yourself.
Just don't point the weapon at yourself. Yeah. And this is because the firing pin is not all automatics have a visible firing pin. Okay, some don't have what we normally refer to as a firing pin. Okay, and if you go like this, it's quite possible. Okay. You have to protect yourself. Okay, another one. Okay, he's here. We've done this one. Okay. This time we're going to do it with the left hand. Okay, and this makes turning the body a little easier. All I'm going to do is whatever distraction come across. I'm going to grab again. Okay, this time I'm going to come into the person and down. Okay. Now again, you can come once you get this over here. You want to come in with two hands, fine. Okay, but it's brought in towards the person and down, and then again back. Okay, your intent is not, you know, you may not, his finger may come out. That's okay. You can't worry about those little things. Okay, but you're here. You take it to the right. If you want to come in with the other hand, fine. Step in, bring it to the person. Okay, and then go back. Down, on the ground, spread eagle, palms up, toes in. Toes in. Good. Quack. If you can give a person all those commands. The reason you go palms up is because if a person is out like this, it's easier for them to bring their hands and get up. If their palms up, okay, then they have to turn their hands over before they do anything. And that's a visual indication to you that they're going to do something. Because I've never seen anyone get up with their hands like that, okay, with their hands palm up. It just doesn't happen, okay? Is it stupid? Yes. Does it work? Yes. You don't care whether it's stupid or not. Okay, so anyone need to see the technique again? Okay, sideways, because I'm doing it one. Okay, they're here, you're here. God, I know your grandmother. Step in. Okay, and then pull back. Get down. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good. Now, one thing I just realized I'm doing something wrong. I'm giving the person the gun back.
Bang.
And I've mentioned this in previous seminars, and we do this because that's why we do in practice so much. Okay, you give the knife back to the person, you give the club back to the person, because you're being polite in the dojo. Unfortunately, there have been instances where that transfers to the street. They give the knife back, give the weapon back. So rather than give the weapon back, put it down on the ground and step back and let your opponent pick up the weapon again, okay? You've got to get away from the condition, because we're trying to develop conditioned responses. And if the conditioned response is after you break the guy's wrists and knock him in the side of the head and maybe blow out his kneecap, you're going to hand him that gun so he can shoot you on the street? You know, does it? Okay, so put the weapon down. Not, you know, and you're likely on the street, you're less, or secure it on your body. Okay, if you're going to secure it in your body, do not stick it in a front pocket. You mainly, well, it doesn't matter what sex you are, going to ruin yourself if it fires. Get it in back, okay? Put it behind you, in your belt, in a back pocket, okay? Yeah, if it fires, you know, you're going to get an extra crease in your butt, but it still decreases your chances of being hurt seriously. Bad pun, I'm going to forget about it. Okay, let's go. How many of you know the basic Tainagi, basic hand throw? Good. How do you get out of the way of the straight knife thrust? What did you just do? You pivoted what? You pivot your right foot back, okay? You've got a gun. I'm knocking it out of the way. I take my right foot, you know, because this may work, but getting your body out of the way gets your body out of the way, okay? And then you can step back in and do this part. But what I'm seeing some people do is they're pushing this away, they're stepping back. And if you go into the physiology of it, if I try to push this way and step back, I'm actually weakening my ability to push that way, because my body is working in the opposite direction, okay? So what you want to do is if I pivot my right foot back, you take the flow of energy, as I put my right foot back and come this way, this is actually strengthening that, because now that's back there to support my forward movement. Okay? Okay, so just remember, you've got, you know, the other problem, he ended up with a corkscrew being done on him. And I don't know how, where is she? Where's this vicious young lady? I don't know what she did, but she ended up somehow with this and like, was it like this somewhat? Left hand was.
He didn't have the hands on
yet. You had it like this.
Yeah.
Okay. She ended up. It wasn't because your arms were crossed. Anyway, her arms were crossed. She says, "What do I do?" And I said, "Corkscrew." Okay. That's why you have to know, you know. As you get to know your techniques better and better, you begin to understand the concept that for the most part the attack is irrelevant. You're going to do whatever technique you end up with, because things do mess up on the street, okay? And all I asked her was, first name?
Kevin.
Ellen?
Kevin.
Helen?
Kelly.
I don't have my hearing aids in. All I asked her is, do you know how to do a corkscrew? She says, yes. I said, do it. And she did it, and you didn't need that finger anyway. okay, and she did it nicely. Okay, so it's just an awareness that, you know, when you mess up, you have to quickly recognize what can I do? Because that's what's going to save your butt on the street. Is, you know, okay. Wanted to do one more, and then we need to switch to rifles to give rifles some fair play. Okay. We're going to take a. Now, can you do the gangster grip? Cool, dude.
You have the face with it too.
That's a little bonus.
Didn't your mommy like you? Okay. This is so easy. You know, first of all, if he fires that weapons, you know, depending on the caliber of the weapon, he has a good. Yeah. First of all, yes. Okay. Well, you have to realize is that when you fire a weapon, it's going any handgun, it's going to go up a little bit. Okay. So, okay, and this way, if it goes up, it could, you know, it could hit the smaller target, which is my head. Okay. On the other hand, if he's holding it sideways and I go this way, I still could possibly get shot. So you go this way. Okay. Now, from here, all we're going to do is, you know, because he's stupid anyway. Okay. If you want, you can do the same technique. This is harder to do, surprisingly, in this position. Okay, it's the same technique we originally shot. But you're going to take this across, okay, and you're going to grab with this hand, and you're going to twist out, okay? And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to come back and smash him right in the face with it, making sure you keep the end of the barrel pointed away from your head, okay? So again, he comes in. Your safety's on. Now, what could you go into? If you're a really good judo person, you come and do Soto Makikomi. Okay. Which works well. Okay. Because that's what the black belt did with the screwdriver. You know, and then he had to, you know, he was stuck there on the ground with the guy for 10 minutes with shoulder lock. Okay, but all we're going to do is he comes in, you're here again, okay, take this out, going to bring it around, grab here, bring it around your body, okay, then come back, strike him in the face with it, okay, and then step back and say, down on the ground, count to 300 backwards, okay.
300.
Okay, so you're going to do that one, okay? If he's left-handed, are you left-handed? Cool, dude! That was basically the first technique. What it was here, back, and that will surprisingly work well at times too. And again, from here, I would probably step back, or you could come in, strike him across the side of the head. One butt should meet the other. Okay. But all I was trying to do was rob him. Okay, so I want you to try to do it right-handed, left-handed. Okay. Okay. So we can get up our torquesis. Okay. Things that came, let me borrow you because you've been drinking too much again. We took it away, okay, and I'm left-handed. Most disarms are easier to do for left-handed people because he's using his right hand. I'm coming in with my left, okay. I'm taking this away, okay. And it's very easy just to rotate it into my left hand, okay, because I'm left-handed, okay. A right-handed person, this is more of a challenge, okay, because you've taken it with the left away, come in this way, here, let go, okay. And now you've got to, rather than rotating it from this end, you have to rotate it from this end to get it into your hand. It actually takes more time, okay? So it's just something to be aware of, okay? The other thing in terms of teaching techniques left and right hand, there are essentially two different philosophies on it. For those of you that are sensei, or if you're working with higher ranks, working with lower ranks, When a person's learning techniques, any technique, sometimes instructors will have you go back and forth. You do it once, I do it once, you do it once, I do it once, okay. If you are switching back and forth, the brain patterning doesn't develop as fast. Then if you say, you do it four or five times, then I'll do it four or five times, okay? Because it allows the person to repeat, by repeating the motion without interruption, they tend to learn it faster, okay? And because to learn any technique, it's a matter of repetition. Something else we're getting into in the new book, okay? I think there's at the beginning, there's a phrase about a new student comes into the dojo, karate dojo, and he's told to start practicing blocking, and he asks the sensei, how many times do I have to do this block? And the sensei says, normally forever, but for you, only 100 times. And most of you that are upper belts, you've done blocks hundreds or thousands of times. You've done koshinagi one way or another, a hip throw, hundreds or thousands of times, okay? It's just, but you don't consider it, oh, now I'm doing a hip throw, I'm add one more to the list, okay? Because you're learning different things with it, okay? But it's the repetition that allows you to get better. Okay, the same concept goes for teaching left-handed and right-handed. Okay, if you constantly switch back and forth, the reinforcement isn't there. Okay, because you're trying to learn. Essentially, you're trying to learn two different things. Okay, so some instructors will say, "Okay, do this right-handed five times. Do it left-handed five times." I'll usually have my students learn everything right-handed, and then when they get to around maybe fifth Q or fourth Q purple belt, I'll say, okay, now let's get the left hand in there, because I want them to have and this is just my personal approach, I want them to have one side down good before they get the other, because then it's easier to, in my book at least, it's easier for them to transition to the other side, because they've got the brain pattern down, they know what they need to do, they just need to switch sides.